Today, we are going to discuss about how to calculate strength. This is the first stage. Next, we are going to solve a few problems, simple problems. How to calculate stress, strain, displacement for the given data. That's what we are going to discuss. So you can see, initially we are going to discuss how to calculate the strength of a material. Strength of a material, you can see in the slide, this is a specimen. This is a specimen we need to prepare. Actually, here this here one point is there, here another point is there. The distance between the two points is known as gauge length. Gauge length, that is L0. That is L0. Above and below we have extension. So this is for holding the workpiece. These portions are used to hold the workpiece in the machine. But for our calculation purpose, we will take only gauge length. How to prepare this specimen? How to prepare this specimen? For this, dimensions are available in ASTME book, American Society of Mechanical Engineers. There is a handbook. In that handbook, for standard tensile testing, what should be the after preparing the specimen? This is the size we required for analysis. That is the distance between the two points. That gauge length, that is L0. Now you can see the machine. This is a universal testing machine. In this machine, there are the base table. There are two columns. In the column, the topmost point, there is a cross head. This is cross head. Fixed. This is a fixed one. Here we have another cross head. This is moving one. And we have, this is a holder for workpiece. Here we have holder at the top as well as bottom. In between these two holder, we can fix the workpiece. Here this cross head is not it is not movable, but this is moving cross head. This can be moved up and down. This is controlled hydraulically. So all controls are available, and whatever the output we get from this specimen is connected with the computer. So for computer, initially we need to give the dimensions. One dimension means only cross section and length. These are all the dimensions required. You need to give those data to the computer. After that, just you start the machine. What it will do is, this moving cross head will be moving. You can move downward as well as upward direction. If you want to give a compressive load to the specimen, you move the cross head in the upward direction. If you want to apply tensile load, you can move in the downward direction. To find compressive stress, compressive load. To find tensile stress, you have to apply a tensile load. When it is moving in the downward direction, the elongation. Here what we usually give is the downward motion. The downward motion will be given at a velocity of 1 mm/min. This is standard value. Generally for standard tensile test, we give a velocity of 1 mm/min. There's a way, but the specimen based on the ASTME standard, this also, this AM is standard. But okay, so now it will be moving in the downward direction. The load is applied. Our objective is to produce a 1 mm/min. That is a velocity. Actually, this is the initial specimen. We considered only the gauge length. So this is the initial specimen. Now the load is applied. There is elongation. There is a elongation. It is slowly elongates. But still there is no failure. Again you apply the load, but the diameter is reducing. Here the diameter is more, here the diameter is less. When applied, load is applied, still diameter is reducing, but the failure, it is not started. But here, see, there is a neck is formed. Keep on, you apply the displacement. At one point, neck is formed. After that, failure takes place, fracture takes place. Now you take the specimens and join together and measure the distance. Measure the distance. This is a final distance. This is a final distance. This is the initial distance. It is before apply load is applied. This is after failure. So now, using this data, you will be able to find all the strength, different strength you will be able to find. But even nowadays, the computer itself will draw the graph. Everything will be given in the given by the computer itself. You need not calculate. If you want to calculate, there is a procedure. So this is a graph obtained during tensile test by the computer. Such a graph will be given by the computer. This is stress, this is strain. This is stress, this is strain. When load is, this is known as elastic limit. This is known as elastic limit. When stress increases, the strain is increasing, it is linear. So that's what we say, within the elastic limit, stress is directly proportional to strain. So we also will only will find stress only during in this portion only. We are not interested in this portion, linear portion. And then if you again you apply the load, it will elongate up to this point. So within this point it is elastic, it will have elastic property. When load is applied and it will elongate, when removed it will regain the original shape. When it goes beyond this point, yield point, after this, when load is removed, it will not regain the original shape. So up to this is a plastic stage. After that, it is an elastic stage. Up to this, it is an elastic stage. After that, it is a plastic stage. So when it reaches a plastic stage, when load is removed, it will not regain the original shape. So as far as material is concerned, the yield point itself considers a failure point. Once the material yield stress crosses this point, crosses this value, the material is considered as a, it need not rupture, it need not fail, it need not break completely. Just it crosses a yield point, then the material is considered as a material is failed in case of ductile material. Because once it deform permanently, the material will not do it work properly. It not serve its purpose properly. Hence, this is a failure point. This is a failure point. Now, again, you give the displacement. Load is not much increasing because it is unable to resist. It is unable to resist. Up to this, it is stable. After that, it is unstable. It is unable to resist. Then load is not increasing much, but strain is increasing. That elongation is increasing. After that, even the load is less, it failure at this point. Here, there are three important points. One is yield point, another one is ultimate point, another one is rupture point. There are three stresses can be calculated. One is yield stress. The stress corresponding to this point is yield stress. You draw a horizontal line. Here you can get the yield stress. This is a maximum. If this is for my own material, in another material it will be different. If you draw a horizontal line from the maximum point, you will get one stress, that is ultimate strength. If you draw a point corresponding to the rupture point, you will get one stress, that is rupture strength, or you can say breaking strength. So in the UTM machine, after testing, you will get three strength. One is yield strength, ultimate strength, and breaking strength. This is a yield strength, this is ultimate strength, this is breaking strength. Generally, breaking strength will be less than the ultimate strength. After it reaching the ultimate strength, the strength stress start decreasing. We need only less amount of force is required to apply the defect, because it is completely unstable. Neck will be formed and it is about to fail. So, but during failure, this will be the strength. So, this is called a stress strain diagram. This you can get from the UTM machine. So, this is another stress diagram for another material. Here, see, almost yield point is here. Yield point is here. And this point is known as ultimate strength point. This is rupture, breaking strength. breaking strength, ultimate strength. This is a, this point. How to calculate this point? No, this point and equine, we can calculate easily. But this point you can calculate by here. You have to take a point to a strain. See, point to strain. Here in the strain value, strain value will be there. Here, corresponding to the point to strain, you draw a line parallel to here. We have a linear line. Parallel to this, you take strain of 0.2 and draw a line parallel to this. It will meet the curve at one point. This is called yield strength. This is called yield strength. Here also, if you want to find this point, if you want to find this point, what you need to do is, you see here there is a 0.2. Strain is 0.2. Now you have to draw a line along this direction, parallel to this line, parallel to this. From the 0.2 strain, you draw a line. It will meet at yield point. This point is known as yield point. This point, it is difficult to find this point, but the rupture point and ultimate, it is you can find easily. But yield point, to find the yield point, you take 0.2 strain and draw a line parallel to the this line. It will meet at one point. This point is known as yield point. The elastic point, as long as it is linear, it is elastic. Elastic limit, that is known as elastic limit. So this is so from this graph, from this data, you can calculate even you can calculate manually also. Another, if you know the load, you can find the stress also. Generally in UTM machine, all the data will be given, the graph will be given directly. You can take the value, but if you want to calculate, you can calculate. You can also calculate. To calculate ultimate strength, you have to substitute the ultimate load divided by area. Ultimate load divided by area. Then if you want to find the breaking stress, breaking load divided by that area. If you want to find elongation, this is the final elongation minus initial elongation divided by initial elongation into 100 will give the percentage of elongation. Similarly, percentage of contraction you can find. That is final area minus initial area divided by initial area into 100. This is not, this is minus. This is minus. You can find the contraction in area also you can find. So three important data you can get from the UTM machine. One is yield strength, another is ultimate strength, another is breaking strength, and percentage of elongation, percentage of contraction. These are the five data you can get from the UTM machine. Now see a specimen failed during UTM machine. This is cylindrical specimen. This is flat specimen because the plates are sometimes the materials are available in the form of plate. Sometimes it will available in the form of rod. So if you want to calculate strength of a plate, then you have to prepare a specimen like this. You have to prepare a specimen like this. If it is a circular rod, you need to prepare a specimen like this for both plate as well as rod. The what should be the dimension? It is available in the ASME data book. That is American Society of Mechanical Engineering data book. You can get the data and you have to prepare the specimen based on the data available. Then you have to use it in a machine. So here this failure is brittle failure. Already we have discussed about ductile material, brittle material. But steel is a brittle material, ductile material. Cast iron is a ductile material. Glass is a brittle material. Cast iron is a brittle material. But steel is a ductile material. Most of the case we will be using steel. But this is not steel. Here you see the type of failure. Type of failure. This is brittle. This is brittle failure because in case of ductile failure, when load is applied, there will be some amount of elongation. After elongation only, there will be a failure will take place. You might have seen the specimen. You might have seen in the specimen. See, in the specimen, see, here the elongation takes place. No, there is a neck will be formed. Then again, it will elongate. Then only failure will take place. There will be a elongation. But in case of brittle failure, it will not be like that. There will be a sudden failure. It will not elongate. Without elongation, the failure will take place. That is another brittle failure. Now see another specimen. This is ductile failure. This is aluminium. this is steel. This is known as cup and cone failure. The contraction neck will be formed. After that only the failure will take place. This is ductile failure. If it is a brittle failure, there will not be any elongation. Then this is a graph for stress strain diagram for different material. This is mild steel. This is cast iron. This is concrete. You can come to a conclusion about what kind of material it is from two. One is by seeing the specimen itself, you can say this is a brittle or ductile material. Another thing is from the graph, stress strain diagram also, you can easily say this is ductile material or brittle material. In case of brittle material, you will get only straight line, almost straight line. This is for concrete, this is for cast iron. Both are brittle material. You will get a line like this, a linear line. Sudden failure will take place. But here see, up to this it is linear. After that, load is less, elongation is more. Load is less, elongation is more. You are applying less amount of load, but it is, so that means it loses its stability. Yeah, that's a way you can identify which kind of material it is, either from the specimen or from the graph. These are the two ways, right? Now let us see what is factor of safety. There is an important term. In design, we will be using this term frequently, factor of safety. Why we need to take factor of safety? I have explained to you what is design. What is design? In case of design, there are two parameters we will be equating. One is strength, another one is stress. One is strength, another one is stress. Strength means it is an inherent property of the material. Stress means when the load is applied, when external load is applied, there will be a resistance is induced in the material. That is stress we studied. As load increases, stress will increase. But strength value, that material strength value will be always constant. Now, if you want to find the dimension, what you need to do is, you have to compare stress and strength. Already stress is a function of load as well as dimension. But strength is a inherent property of the material. Right. Now, generally, you assume that the strength of the material is 100 megapascal. Strength of the material is 100 megapascal. Using this material, you want to design a component, say shaft. For calculation purpose, we will not take the 100. Maximum value will not take. Yield strength is 100. We won't take the 100. We take some 50. That means we divide the original strength by factor of safety. Then only after dividing the original value, you will get one value. No, that is known as, we can say, allowable stress, working stress, design stress, or safe stress. You can call it by any name. You can say allowable stress, working stress, design stress, or safe stress. However, the strength of the material is, we design for yield strength only. We design the material for yield strength. Yield strength is 100. But while for designing purpose, we won't take the same 100 megapascal. For design purpose, we take only 50. Why we take 50 means there are some reasons are there. Suppose, for example, if the material is supposed to give 100 megapascal, but in the manufacturing, if the manufacturing is not done properly, right? While doing for manufacturing, we have to follow some set of procedures. If it is not followed properly, then we will not get the expected strength. The strength may be less than that value. So there are possibility of uncertainty in another manufacturing problem. Due to manufacturing problem, there may be another reduction in strength. And not only that, for example, a bike is designed for two persons. bike is designed for 2 person each, 75 kg, 150 kg. It is designed for 150 kg, but in actual practice people are traveling 3-4, we load up to even 200 kg. It is designed for 50 only, but in actual practice the people are using, are loading 200 kg. But so in such cases, if we design for some the same strength, it won't withstand. No, it, the stress will go beyond that. So there are possibility, there are uncertainty in load. So due to these reasons, due to uncertain loading condition and uncertainty manufacturing, we should not take the original strength. You have to divide the original strength by factor safety. That value only you have to take for design purpose. That value is known as allowable stress. You can say working stress or design stress or safe stress, whatever it may be, you can take. So why we need to take factor safety? Because of uncertainty in load, uncertainty in manufacturing problem, even sometimes uncertainty in the working condition. Actually, the materials are designed for working in the closed room. Sometimes the machines are operated in the atmospheric condition. That will be subjected to different weather conditions. That also will affect. So due to many reasons, we should not take the original strength. That must be divided by some factor safety. And then only you have to take that. After dividing by factor safety is known as, that is a safe stress. Right. Now, while designing the design, you have to take, instead of the strength, you have to take the safe strength. Safe strength is equal to stress. By comparing this, you will be able to find the unknown dimension. Right? This is about factor safety. The factor safety value, normally we take from 2 to 10. 2 to 10. When we take 2, when there are another, when there is a failure, due to failure, it will not lead to loss of life, then you can take 2. If it is lead to loss of life, then you have to take 10. For example, if you are designing a crane rope, while lifting the load, people will be working under the crane. If any failure happens, it will lead to loss of life. You take a dam. If there is a failure, it will lead to loss of life. Similarly, there are many applications where there is an aeroplane. If any failure, that will lead to loss of life. In such cases, you need to take more factor safety. Some cases, you take a lathe. Even there is a failure, it will lead to only loss of money. So in such cases, you can take less factor safety. Even sometimes you take 1.5 also. Sometimes you take 10. So it is depending upon the situation. You can take the factor safety. Now let us discuss about the problems, right? So how to calculate strength using UTM machine, we discussed. After calculating the strength, you should not use the strength as it is. It must be divided by factor safety. Why it must be divided by factor safety also we discussed. Now let us see problem. We are going to see two problems. Now see, it's a simple problem. It is a very simple problem. A circular bar, 20 mm in diameter and 200 mm long is subjected to a force of 200 kilonewton. Find the stress, strain, elongation if the value of Young's modulus is 80 gigapascal. So this is a problem. 20 mm diameter, 200 mm long, 20 kilonewton force, and Young's modulus is 80 gigapascal. Now we will solve this problem. Length of the specimen is equal to 200 millimeter, and load P is equal to, I think this is 20 kilonewton. It is 20 kilonewton, and Young's modulus Young's modulus is equal to 80 gigapascal. 80 gigapascal. Now you convert all the dimensions. It is in mm. It's all right. Length is not 200. I think it is 200. Length is 200 millimeter. 200 millimeter. The load is 20 kilonewton. You take in newton. 20 into 1000. 20 into 1000. And Young's modulus is in gigapascal. You convert this into newton per millimeter square. Then only finally final answer will be in proper unit. It is in gigapascal. You have to convert this gigapascal into 80 into giga means 10 power 9 pascal. Right? Now 1 pascal is equal to how much? 80 into 10 power 9. Pascal is equal to newton per meter square. Newton per meter square. Then now you convert that into newton per millimeter square into 10 power 9 newton per millimeter square. You have to put millimeter square. We know that 1 meter is equal to 1000 or 10 power 3. 10 power 3 millimeter. So in the place of meter square, so 1 meter is equal to 10 power 3 millimeters, a millimeter. In the place of meter, you substitute that. So this is 10 power 3 square. 10 power 3 square millimeter square. Now the value, what is the value? That will be 8 into 10 power 3 square. So 10 power 6. 10 power 6. So this is 10 power 3. Now, this is a specimen. This is a specimen. And how much load is applied? 20 kilonewton. 20 kilonewton. This also 20 kilonewton. Actually, this is a way how to represent. When a specimen is subjected to 20 kilonewton load, this is a way you have to specimen. Because why you have to specimen like this now? For example, if you specify like this now, this is a specimen. Load is applied one side. What will happen if you apply load on only one side? What will happen? Here there will be friction. Here there will be a friction between this is a surface, this is a specimen. Between the material, the structure and ground, friction will be there. If the friction is more than 20, the body will not move. If the friction is less than 20, it will start moving. Say, assume that the friction is more than the 20 kilonewton. It means there is a opposite force. Opposite force is acting. This is an action, this is a reaction. Reaction is given because of the friction. So this also will be equal to 20 newton. 20 kilonewton. That's what we represent like this. Similarly, you assume that this is a wall. In a wall, a structure is fixed like that. 20 kilonewton is acting. 20 kilonewton is acting here. Now, 20 kilonewton is acting here. Now, this will not move. When you apply a 20 kilonewton in this direction, this is not moving. Why? There is an opposite reaction is given by wall. How much? 20 kilonewton. That's what it is. Another stationary. It is static. Otherwise, it will move. So, if a body is subjected to 20 kilonewton, this is action, this is reaction. You have to mention like this. It doesn't mean that 40 kilonewton is acting. One is action, another one is reaction. So, but actually this is applied only 20 kilonewton. So then if you want to find stress, what is stress? Stress is equal to load by area. What is load? 20,000 newton divided by what is area? Pi by 4 d square. cross section area. This is a cross section area. When you view from the side, you will be like this. The cross section area. This is a cross section area. That is pi by 4 d square. Pi, we know what is d diameter is 20. So 20 square divided by 4. So this will give the stress. Next step is you need to calculate what stress then strain. We know on equation Young's modulus is equal to stress by strain. Now strain is equal to stress by Young's modulus. We know stress already have calculated here. We already Young's modulus is given. How much? 18 into 10 power 3 newton per millimeter square. You have to put only newton per millimeter square. Already we have substituted load in newton. This diameter in millimeter. So you will get newton per millimeter square. Newton per millimeter square. E also newton per millimeter square. So both unit gets cancelled. You will get strain. Strain no unit. No unit. Right? Finally, you are asked to find the elongation. You know, change in length divided by original length is equal to strain. Using this equation, change in length is equal to strain multiplied by original length. What is strain? Already we have calculated here, no unit. What is length? 200 millimeters. You substitute here and find the value. What will be the change in length? Some value in what is the unit? Millimeter. Already length is millimeter. This is has no unit. So change in length is equal to millimeter. You can solve this problem like this.